microphone work? Yes, it does. Good morning, brothers and sisters, boys and girls. My name is John Mark. And you may think, who is John Mark? But you actually do know me. I just need to tell you a little bit more about me. I was an early believer in the Christian church. And my parents were Miriam, which is Jewish for Mary, and Johanan, which is Jewish for John. And they named me, sort of a combination of those two words, John Mark, Johannes Marcus. But I'm just known to you as John Mark. So I am wearing a Jewish prayer shawl because I was raised Jewish. But then my parents heard about Jesus and they accepted what we call the way. Nowadays we call it Christianity. They accepted Christ. And so I was raised in their home and I am John Mark. Not only that, but later in my life, I was the one who wrote the gospel called Mark. So see, you do know me, don't you? So, so now that you've met my alternate character, John Mark, let me remind you, I'm actually Rob Irwin, okay? And if I can get my PowerPoint to work the way I think it should work. This is a painter's conception of John Mark. This was a Renaissance painter. It actually says his name, Frans Hals. He was a Dutch painter, and the date is 1625. And so this is a conception of what John Mark might have looked like. No one actually has any image of him, so someone imagined this. But I think it's nice sometimes to be able to imagine also. So most of the ideas in the sermon I'm presenting to you come from the Bible, but some of them come from other sources. For example, in the early Christian church, there were historians who wrote about things. And so some of those historians informed the things I'm going to be sharing with you. And I believe that by learning more about a Bible character like John Mark, and if we can understand him and see how real he was, it may make the Bible more real for us. And that's always a good thing for me. And it also then helps us understand the Bible more thoroughly or carefully. Let's see if I can get my mouse to make this screen work from a distance. Yeah, it worked, okay. So I've already mentioned this kind of thing, that John Mark was the son of Mary. By the time that Jesus began his active ministry and by the time that the events of Jesus' crucifixion occurred, John Mark had lost his father, we think, but his mother was still a very avid supporter of the early Christian church. Mary was the aunt of Barnabas. You know Barnabas in the Bible, who served with Paul. So that makes John Mark and Barnabas cousins, right? So there's another connection. And not only that, Mary and her husband had been very successful financially as a couple. Church historians believe they had two homes, a home in Cana. Nita says Cana, so that's the way I'm going to say it, Cana. And then they had a home in Jerusalem as well. So that was a different kind of wealth from the average person in the time of Jesus. And their home in Jerusalem, actually, we believe, was the site of a number of activities of the early Christian church, including probably the upper room. So in a normal home in Jerusalem, there wouldn't be very much space. But a wealthy family might have a second story. So maybe they live on the first floor, and the second story might be like for larger social occasions. And so we think maybe it's possible that that upper room was where the believers met for the Last Supper. So we think that John Mark was probably a convert to Christianity through Peter, actually. Because later we read that Peter refers to John Mark as his son. So that's probably like it was Peter who mentored John Mark and helped him become a Christian and was like a father to him spiritually. So these are things about John Mark that are things that you might have known something about, but I want to help you see it all together as a story. So I'm going to try to relate John Mark's life story, and I hope that it will help you see John Mark and other Bible characters as real people, and it's been helpful for me. John Mark was an associate of Paul, actually on a missionary journey or two. So let's think a little more about John Mark. Maybe by the end of this, I'll be good at putting this on without messing up the microphone. It's a trick. So you remember when Jesus told his disciples to go and find a room because it was Passover and they were going to have a special meal. So in those days, having a Passover meal was a special event, took preparation. Jesus said, let's go get it ready, go into the city, and you will see a man carrying a jug of water and follow him, and he will give you a room. What if that was somebody in Mary's household? What if that's how it was arranged? And so the disciples that Jesus sent went up to this upper room. They got it all ready so that when it was time for that Passover meal, that Last Supper, it was ready. And so I want to tell you that my mother was right there when Jesus was doing all of his things, but I was just a boy. I was probably a young teenager. And these things were happening in my house. Disciples were coming and going. Peter was there. But I was just a kid. But it was really interesting. And Barnabas, my cousin, was around. And so my mother was an eyewitness to the stories of Jesus doing all of these things. She was there and saw them. Barnabas was around, and I was around for some of it. And I didn't really realize it at the time about my family's wealth. But because we had this nice house with lots of room, you know, we could host things there. And so we did. We had a lot of the early believers at our house. And I never realized how special that was when I was a child, but it was really special. And I spent a lot of time with Peter. So I'm going to take this off. I have to be very careful. I'll knock the microphone off. So there are several references to John Mark in the New Testament. I don't believe you can read all of this very well. I just wanted you to see the general idea that there are multiple references to John Mark in the New Testament. So right here we have references in the book of Mark. And when John Mark wrote the book of Mark, and when he referred to himself, he didn't actually name himself. He implied things, and we can infer that it was actually John Mark that he was writing about himself. For example, the arrangements for the upper room for the Last Supper. We don't know with certainty, but what if it was Mary's home? That could be true. In the Garden of Gethsemane, we think John Mark was there. There are seven references in the book of Acts to to places or events where we think John Mark was involved. When the disciples met in an upstairs room after the resurrection, we suspect that was actually this family's house because it was like a meeting place. And another time, the disciples met for special prayer after the release of Peter and John from prison. And we know with certainty that in Acts 12, when Peter met the believers in the middle of the night, that was, we know that was the home of John Mark. There's no ambiguity about that. And then Paul and Barnabas take John Mark to Antioch. John Mark also goes along on Paul's first missionary journey. John Mark leaves that missionary journey, and then later Paul and Barnabas part ways because of John Mark. And then in multiple places in the epistles, Paul refers to Mark, by Mark he's actually referring to John Mark. And Peter also refers to Mark. He calls him my son. So the first mention of John Mark is in implication, and it's in Mark 14. So let me tell you about that. So after the Last Supper, Jesus and the disciples left the upper room, and Jesus led them all to the Garden of Gethsemane. And I was not a disciple, but I tagged along. They were going out, and I tagged along. And I didn't really take time to get dressed. I just grabbed something and wrapped it around me. We were pretty informal in those days. And so we went up to the Garden of Gethsemane, and as we get up there, you know, I'm just a young teenager, and I don't think I'm supposed to be there, but I'm there, and I'm kind of off on the side in the shadows, and I got drowsy. Everybody got drowsy. In fact, we were all just kind of asleep. I don't know what Jesus was doing, but suddenly there was a noise, and I woke up, and there was this mob there as if they were going to arrest Jesus. And Judas came up to Jesus and kissed him on the cheek, and then the next thing I knew, they were grabbing at Jesus to arrest him. And then Peter found a sword, and he sliced off the ear of one of the priest's servants. And then to my amazement, Jesus picked up the ear and reattached it to the servant right there in front of me. And then they started to drag him off, and they were trying to grab all of us. And I'm ashamed of this, but we just ran. The disciples ran, and I ran, and someone grabbed at me, and they grabbed that like garment I wrapped around me, and I just let him keep it. I ran off. I didn't have anything on, but I was getting out of there. That was not a safe place. But I'm ashamed to tell you this because I should have stayed there with Jesus, and I should have defended him. But we were all scared, and we just ran. Can you imagine that? And in Mark 14, 30 and 32, it just says a young man was there and he fled. Why would anyone include that in that story unless it was John Mark himself? Because we know he was young. And in fact, the other three Gospels do not mention that at all. Only do we see that in the Gospel of Mark. So a lot of scholars believe John Mark put himself in the story. He was there, and he went ahead and relayed that as a way of saying, I was an eyewitness to these things. It happened. I was there. So that's a mention of him. later, after Jesus was crucified, and then he was raised from the dead, we were all frightened, but we still wanted to follow Jesus and do what Jesus was expecting of us. And so we got together, and we used my mother's house. We got together in the house, and we huddled there, and that's where the disciples initially met to try and replace Judas, the betrayer. And they eventually chose Matthias, as you know, to be the 12th disciple, following God's direction. Then after the miracle of Pentecost, as Peter and John were arrested for preaching about Christ, and then they were released, they met at our house again to pray and consecrate themselves for Jesus. And the Holy Spirit was present, and there was like a shaking in the house. It was amazing and humbling. And the disciples were filled with the Spirit, and they spoke God's word boldly, even though they had just been arrested. Then sometime later, Peter was arrested again and put in prison, and many of us were at my family's house praying all night for Peter. And I think you probably know the story. A knock came to the door, and everybody was afraid because no one was supposed to be knocking on the door in the middle of the night. And so our servant girl, I remember I told you our family was kind of wealthy, so we had a servant girl, Rhoda, and she went to the door, and there was actually an outer door, and she went and peeked out the outer door, and she saw Peter. And she was so excited, she came running back in without letting Peter in. She said, "Peter's out there." And so we couldn't believe it. And so we went out and brought Peter in, and we were so relieved. We were rejoicing. And we felt like God had been so amazing to rescue Peter, because we actually thought Peter was going to be put to death. And so we got Peter back. That was in my family's house. Now that part about Rhoda and Peter coming to the door, that is documented in Acts 12 as the house of John Mark. It actually is Mary's house, John Mark's mother. And John Mark is still a young man. So in a way you could say, because John Mark was there and he was involved, it's almost like he was an unnamed young 13th disciple. Because he was there and involved, he was paying attention. It's something that reminds me that just because you're young doesn't mean you can't be involved. Just because you're young doesn't mean you can't do great things along with God's calling. Around this time, the Apostle Paul and our cousin Barnabas came to Jerusalem from Antioch, where they had been anointed for service and where they had been teaching about Jesus. And after they finished meeting with the believers in Jerusalem, they invited me to come with them to Antioch. So I went back to Antioch with them. And by now I'm a little older, but I'm still pretty young. We go back to Antioch, and Paul and Barnabas, remember, Barnabas is my cousin, but Paul is this amazing leader, and I got to be right there with him. And they said, "We're going to go on a missionary journey. Why don't you come too?" And I thought, wow, what a privilege, what an honor. And so I went along with Paul and Barnabas on Paul's first missionary journey. You know, he had at least three missionary journeys, and I was there on the first one. And I'm just a kid, well, a relative kid. So we go off, and we travel to one place, and then what really shocked me was how cruel people were to us. We were early Christians, in a pagan culture. People didn't like us, and they treated us roughly. We went to Perga, and we started to go inland from there to witness. And around that time, I just got overwhelmed with how hard it was. People saying bad things about us, lying about us, accusing us, wanting to arrest us. And I actually left them. I'm not even sure I told them I was leaving. I just left. And I went back home to Jerusalem, where everything seemed safe. So this is the next time we do hear about Barnabas is on the first missionary journey. And you've heard of this. And Paul says that Barnabas and he were doing this work, but then John Mark, and these are Paul's words, deserted us. Paul was bothered. He was annoyed. We do know that missionary life was hard because in 2 Corinthians 11, Paul talks about all the things he suffered as a missionary. He was shipwrecked. They attempted to stone him. You know, they did all these different things. They arrested him. So we know life was hard. And we can only imagine that John Mark was not apparently mature enough. I don't know. He was just... You know, he came up in a wealthy family. I'm sorry to tell you this, but did you know when children are raised in wealth, sometimes they're kind of soft? Sometimes. Not all the time. Sometimes, though. Maybe John Mark was just not ready for a tough existence. And so he goes home. Paul and Barnabas continue their mission work. And we go to the next chapter in John Mark's life. I remember that time well. Paul felt that I had deserted him, and maybe I had deserted them, but I just wasn't ready for the tough service as a missionary. All the confrontations with authorities and evil men. I was shocked at the treatment that we have. But I hung out. I stayed in Jerusalem with my family, and I was there another couple of years. And Paul and Barnabas came back around from their missionary travels. And to my amazement, Barnabas wanted me to go again on a missionary trip. I'd been on one, I kind of flunked out, and Barnabas invites me again. And then I learned that Paul and Barnabas were having an argument, and I listened in, and you'd never believe what they were arguing about. They were arguing about me. Paul said, no, we're not taking John Mark with us. And Barnabas said, but he needs another chance. Let's bring him along. And Paul said, no. And Barnabas said, yes. So they argued, and you know what happened? They ended up dividing their mission trip. Paul went one way, Barnabas went another way, and Barnabas brought me along. I couldn't believe it, that I got another chance. And I went on a second mission trip, this time only with Barnabas. And, you know, I learned something. I saw that even when people are filled with the Holy Spirit, and they're dedicated to God and doing God's work, they could still have disagreements. They had an honest disagreement, and I was at the center of it. But you know, I think that it may have worked out for the good because two mission teams can do more than one mission team. And so we had two mission teams going out there, and somehow God turned it into something good. So this tells us something, doesn't it? In this life, sometimes we'll have disagreements with people who are fellow believers, also dedicated. And maybe If Paul and Barnabas could have a disagreement and move on, maybe we can do that in 2024. It shouldn't be a commonplace. We should be able to work together most of the time. But if we have disagreements, maybe that's just something that happens. And God might be able to turn it into something good like he did it for Paul and Barnabas. And you know, there is that promise, all things work together good, together for good. So, well, let me become John Mark again. So, after the missionary work with cousin Barnabas, I had opportunity to work with Paul again. Part of that time, Paul was in house arrest in Rome. You remember that happened to him. He got arrested. Because he was a Roman citizen, they took him to Rome for trial. And he was under arrest, but he was allowed to be in a house. So there he is in house arrest. And I ended up helping Paul in Rome. And he actually mentioned me in some of his letters. So let's see if I actually... Yes, so Paul mentioned me in some of his letters to the churches, saying that John Mark, or Mark, was helpful. And I was so pleased because I had been a problem, and now I was helpful. That's all I wanted to do, was be helpful. And Paul thought of me as helpful. I also really respected Peter the Apostle, and I spent time with him and worked closely with him. And I actually ended up interpreting Peter's sermons. Peter would go out and preach, but he spoke Aramaic, and some of his audiences didn't know Aramaic. And so I would interpret for Peter to his audiences. So he was telling the sermon, telling the stories of Jesus. I was interpreting those stories for an audience that didn't know Aramaic. And as I did that over and over again, I memorized all the stories. I knew his sermons by heart because I'd been interpreting them for various audiences. And as Peter told me these eyewitness stories of Jesus over and over again, they became my stories as well. And as I told you before, Peter referred to me as his son. So I was like his spiritual son. So I was very honored that I got to work with Paul and Barnabas and Peter. Later, Peter sent me to Alexandria to be a missionary to Alexandria, and I went there on my own. This is not recorded in the New Testament, but in church history, that's where they captured this. So I went to Alexandria, which is the second largest city in the Roman Empire at that time, and I became a missionary to Alexandria. I was the leader of that mission effort. And so I'm glad that Barnabas didn't give up on me, and I was eventually able to help all of these folks serving God. I'm just going to stay. While I was in Rome the last time assisting Paul, we received word that our beloved brother Peter had been martyred. And he had been like my spiritual father, and we grieved over his loss. And then it occurred to me, as I was grieving, who's going to tell Peter's stories? Who's going to relay to the audiences about Jesus? Peter was right there. He saw it, and now he's gone. Who's going to do it? And I was convicted that I could do it. I could write down those stories, and then perhaps others could read about Jesus. Peter was martyred in Rome, and I actually wrote his stories out as if I was writing for the people in Rome. These were Gentiles, not Jewish people, and I wanted them to understand about Jesus. So I wrote down Peter's stories for that audience. So imagine this. He was a missionary dropout, and then he becomes an interpreter for Peter. Then he tells the stories of Peter. Then he writes them down, and then they end up, we believe that, of course, that the Holy Spirit was guiding him all along the way in his mission work, but also in writing out the Gospel of Mark. And so from being a missionary flunky, he becomes one of the four gospel writers in the New Testament. And so he was used by God in this amazing way. So I'm going to advance through here. Many scholars believe that the Gospel of Mark was the first gospel to be written down on paper. Obviously, Matthew, Mark, and John wrote their gospels, but many scholars believe Mark was the first one to commit the stories about Jesus' life to paper. As I was writing these things down, and I was telling the stories of Peter to an audience that had not met Jesus personally, I was so excited to be able to write this down. So I was writing, and I was excited, and I got absorbed in this whole writing effort. I would write and write and write, and in my writing, because I was excited about these stories, I used words of excitement. I would say immediately, straight away. And in fact, someone later told me I used the Greek word euthaos, which means immediately. I used it 47 times in my story because I was excited and I saw Jesus as a man, a holy man, a God man. He was part of the Godhead, but he was also a man of action. So in my gospel, there's not a lot about what he said. There's more about what Jesus did, his actions. And so that's why those features are in my writing. So I want to ask you, haven't you already been blessed in your previous reading of the book of Mark? Isn't it a wonderful gospel? Now as you read it, again, and I encourage you to do that, be on the lookout for words that say immediately, straight away, because this is like a hallmark of John Mark's writing. He was excited about this, and he wanted us to hear about this. So it begs the question, what if Barnabas had given up on Mark? What would have happened then? Would he have just done the thing that was easy for him to do? It would have been easy for him as a son in a wealthy family to just say, I'll just laze around. I don't have any money worries. I don't need to do anything. I can just enjoy myself. But as far as we know, he turned his back on a life of luxury in order to answer the call and to serve God and to risk his life. In fact, all of the early disciples, did you know they were all martyred except for one, John? John was exiled to the Isle of Patmos, but every one of them in early church history says that John Mark was also martyred in a horrible way. When they martyred them, they weren't trying to give them an easy out, you remember? So if the early church history is correct, John Mark himself suffered a horrible, torturous death. The early church historians believe that it happened in Alexandria, where he had gone to do his missionary work. Well, I think that we've been blessed by Mark's gospel, and one of the stories about Peter's sermons was the one about the blind man. Remember Jesus was healing the blind man to make him help him see? And he touched his eyes, and the man said, I see people, but they look like people walking, trees walking. And then, so Jesus touched his eyes again, and then he said, now I can see clearly. This is almost a metaphor for John Mark. He was growing, wasn't he? As I've relayed his story, you can see John Mark growing to greater maturity as a person, but also greater maturity as a believer. He went on a missionary journey. He was not mature enough, and he flunked out, so to speak. He goes on another missionary journey, and this time he's able to stick with it. He leaves the wealth of his family to enter a life and a calling of service to God. So he grows. And like the blind man who was touched repeatedly, John Mark was touched by the Holy Spirit repeatedly, and he grew. What can we learn from all of this? Well, let me skip ahead. Oh, I just wanted to show you briefly. These are some of the passages in the Gospel of Mark that show Jesus' actions. Breaking the roof of the house, sleeping, Jesus sleeping in the storm, arranging the crowd into groups, healing the deaf and dumb man, and so on. So let me skip ahead. So he could have just enjoyed his life of wealth and luxury, but he didn't. Another lesson is encouragement can change a life. Barnabas actually encouraged John Mark, didn't he? He said, come on, let's do it again. I want you to come with me. Let's try it again. We could even consider John Mark to be the youngest disciple. And just as God reclaimed John Mark's ministry, he can reclaim and re-energize your ministry at any time. Another lesson is that when our life is submitted to God, there's no limit to what he can do with us. And our age is not a limitation, if we're young or if we're older. And when we follow God, we will mature spiritually as we live with him and learn from him. Another lesson is that mistakes are not as important as what you can learn from your mistakes. So what we see in this story is that when this young man associated with the early believers, the apostles, and as the Holy Spirit led Mark, he produced a written gospel about the life of Jesus that is still read by millions today. Who could have imagined that this would happen? And so, to me, this is a story of encouragement that our lives can be meaningful, productive, successful as we give ourselves to him. So that's the story of John Mark. And again, I want to say, I hope that as you consider that this is probably his life story, I hope you see how real these Bible characters are, and that God is real, and that his promises are real, and that we can have these in our lives if we just open ourselves to them. Let me finish there and invite the worship team to come forward and lead us in a closing song.